In this series of videos, I'm going to go through all the individual steps involved in recording and analyzing ERPs. There are a lot of steps, and I'll just give you a brief overview. If you want to learn the details, you know where to look. My goal in this set of videos is for you to learn enough so that you can understand the methods and results sections of ERP papers. To make this concrete, we'll go through the actual methods and results sections of a paper from my lab as we cover each step of the process. I've chosen this study that was conducted by Felix Bacigalupo several years ago when he was a grad student in my lab. The goal of the study was to see whether ERPs could be used to assess aversive conditioning. For decades, researchers have studied aversive conditioning using the skin conductance response, which is related to the sweaty palms you get when you're nervous. Felix thought the late positive potential of the ERP waveform might also be a useful measure of aversive conditioning, directly measuring brain activity rather than secondary changes in the skin. As you may recall, the LPP is elicited by emotionally arousing stimuli, whether they're positive or negative. So it would make sense that you'd also see an LPP for stimuli that have been associated with negative outcomes in a conditioning paradigm. Okay, let's take a look at the methods section of the paper, starting with the participants. We had a total of 70 participants, which is much more than you'd see in most ERP studies. A typical ERP study using within-subject comparisons would have between 15 and 30 participants. Some ERP studies have more, especially when they're looking at between-group comparisons or individual differences. Statistical power in ERP experiments depends on both the number of subjects and the number of trials per subject. If you want to know more, I recommend this paper by Baker et al. Felix's study used color stimuli, so he screened subjects for normal vision. The subjects were college students with an average age of 21 years. Now let's talk about the stimuli and task. I want to start by pointing out this section, which explicitly states that we presented the stimuli on a specific model of LCD monitor. Recall that we need to send an event code from the stimulus presentation computer to the EEG recording computer to mark the onset time of each stimulus. This becomes time zero when we epoch the data and make our average ERP waveforms. If the event code doesn't occur at the exact time of stimulus onset, then all our latencies will be wrong. The problem with LCDs is that there's a delay between when the computer sends them the video signal and when the image actually appears on the screen. I've seen delays as long as 32 milliseconds. So we always measure the delay and shift the event code accordingly. In this experiment, it was only an 8 millisecond delay. Now let's go over the aversive conditioning procedure. Participants saw a sequence of stimuli. Each stimulus was a small colored disc in the center of the display. Stimulus duration was 4 seconds, followed by an intertrial interval of 10 to 12 seconds. Here's the task figure from the paper. The aversive stimulus was a 1.5 second white noise burst. This is referred to as the unconditioned stimulus, or US. It was 100 decibels, which isn't loud enough to damage the ears, but was really unpleasant. It literally knocked me out of the chair the first time I heard it. The colored circle in the middle of the display was one of three different colors, blue, green, or yellow. One color was the conditioned stimulus, or CS+, which was associated with the white noise burst. When the CS+ was presented, it had a 50% chance of being followed by the noise burst 2.5 seconds after the onset of the CS+. These are called CS+, US+ trials. On the other 50% of CS+ trials, no noise burst was presented. These are CS+, US- trials. The other two colors were associated with the absence of the noise burst and were called CS- stimuli. We counterbalanced which color was CS+, and which colors were CS-. The CS- stimuli were never followed by a noise burst. As a result, participants learned that the aversive noise bursts often occurred following the CS+ color, but never occurred following the CS- color. The question was whether the CS+ would elicit a larger LPP than the CS-.